everybody, and welcome to EIF Hardcore Sacrifice. It's the sixth annual installment, and of course, as always, your host, EIF owner Carney, getting set for what will be a memorable night, and of course, so much going on, so much already happening. Hybrid opening us up with a great hype video, along with some commentary for a pre-show match that went a little longer than we expected, but you know what? Extreme Rules. This is the arena we're using. Hardcore Sacrifice. Those two terms mean one thing. There are no rules. It doesn't matter. We're throwing the rule book out, and we're starting off with an Extreme Rules match between the Superstardom Champion and one of his two challengers that he will defend the belt against next month at the Superstars Reborn pay-per-view. DZ and James kicking it off, and they're looking to tear the house down here right off the get-go. Untamed and Big Steph certainly set the stakes up for what will be a tough match to come by. Those two fought for about 20 minutes or so. Very entertaining contest between those two individuals, and we're hoping for another one between these two. Weapons all legal, all good in the hood. Only thing is, you have to win by pinfall, and you have to pin your opponent inside the ring. The following contest is our opening matchup of the evening, and is scheduled for one fall, contested under Extreme Rules. Introducing first, in the top right corner, from Florida, this is James Arcuffo. And introducing his opponent, standing across the ring from him, from Cleveland, Ohio, this man is the current reigning EIF Undisputed Superstardom Champion, DZ. All right, guys, let's get this pay-per-view on the road. Ding, ding, ding. Just like that, we are underway. No formalities between these two. DZ and James, Extreme Rules. Hardcore Sacrifice, and what a way to start out. Who would have thought the first move would be an over-the-top rope senton from James Arcoffel, but they're going to take advantage of no ring out count. They are not on Superstardom, which is, of course, a more binded brand that features a lot more rules applied. These two are throwing everything in the kitchen sink out at each other. James Arcoffel to the apron. It looks like he'll head back in. Instead, he drops down. DZ underneath the ring apron, and I think James is going to go with him. Here comes some home redecorating. A table, which we'll see in our later match. DZ with the sledgehammer, and he got wedged out with the table. DZ now taking the table away from James. James avoiding the table shot, the second one he does not avoid. DZ now placing that table in underneath the bottom rope. We will see a tables match be taking place also here tonight for the Intercontinental Championship as the Superstardom Champion begins sledging in James with that sledgehammer. Now DZ running, trying to get through chalk zone. Ain't going to work. James getting back to both feet. DZ will roll in underneath the bottom rope. And now James Arcoffel unraveling one of the announce tables by ringside. DZ setting up a table in the corner. And now unraveling a turnbuckle. Well, you kick the show off with an Extreme Rules match. And this match was just announced by the EIF Twitter account just a little over an hour ago. So this is brand new on the card. And these guys are trying to make sure they don't go overlooked. DZ with a steel chair on one side. James Arcoffel, we got a ladder now. TLC, baby. DZ putting that chair wedged in the turnbuckles, and now James Arcoffel climbing the ladder. What are these guys thinking? DZ trying to grapple me. James Arcoffel misses horrifically, and to the outside he goes. I have no idea what DZ is trying to do. I don't know if he's in the same match as me or what. DZ is diving out towards me. He's coming my way. I don't compete anymore, Buster. And now they both continue the horrific grappling. Targeting an issue, obviously these two are not fans of Manuel. DZ, it's hard to see, but it looks like he just suplexed James on those steel steps. Kind of difficult to see with that table in the way. Hopefully you guys can get a decent view. DZ with steel steps, I'm doing my best not to make sure their targeting issues don't occur, as DZ wants to probably come after me. Don't attack me, please. This cameraman will do the best he can to get out of the way. Remember, this isn't like the simple normal matches. Normally, I'd be able to just get out of the way. I can't do that right now. James Arcoffel. We got the baseball bat now. DZ with a set of steel steps. Extreme Rules living up to the hype. Weapons everywhere. James Arcoffel going slugging here against DZ, a fan of the Cleveland Indians, but they're in Philadelphia right now, and DZ is stuck here in the EIF Arena to deal with James R. Coffle, who's going to bat away, but DZ taking it away from him. Baseball bat in between the eyes of James R. Coffle, and DZ will rid the ring of that weapon. It is not a favorite among EIF superstars, at least the superstars that care about fair play. James R. Coffle going to try and exit the ring and avoid those steel step shots, and he will. And now targeting, yet again, an issue. James, yet again, going under the ring. I don't know that he can get another weapon out. And somehow he can. I have no idea how this ring has so much weaponry. DZ taking that kendo stick away from James R. Coffle, and a big shot right in between the eyes to James R. Coffle. Of course, we can see weapons throughout the night, and especially in our main event, Falls Count Anywhere. Rat looking greedy. You saw the tail of the tape kind of showcased in our hype video tonight. Hybrid Maniac's going to be the third man in as Hybrid and Rat Luck back-to-back hardcore sacrifices last year and this. In the main event, Greedy the defending world champion. Can he stave off two of the top superstars in EIF? James thrown headfirst into the steel chair in the corner. That's our main event. We're going to have to wonder how we're even going to make it that far. These two are tearing the building apart right now. Certainly the ring for sure. DZ with a forearm to the face of James. And now plunging into the ring. DZ getting caught, and a powerbomb connects for James R. Coffle. That triple threat is the main event of tonight. 2 weeks from now on EIF's sixth annual Superstars Reborn pay-per-view, which is exclusively Superstardom, James R. Coffle, along with NBC Master, who will be seen later on this evening, will be challenging DZ in a triple threat. The stipulation is yet to be picked by NBC Master as DZ ducks underneath James, kicks him in the midsection out. DZ with a kendo shot right across James and over the head. James buried in the corner. DZ now, I don't think I've ever seen this. DZ choking the life out of James with that kendo stick in the corner. I don't know if I ever saw that in the game. I didn't even know that was a thing. And now DZ throwing the kendo stick out to James. Steel steps being brought in hand by DZ, and James obviously having to rethink some strategy now. I mean, he's been taking a beat down by DZ, the Superstardom champion. He and James both Battle for Glory competitors, both underseeds. In fact, they are respectively 15 and 16. James R. Coffle now from the top of the ladder, diving into the ring, and he caught DZ. Both men are down. In fact, both these two are going up against two of the people main eventing tonight's show. DZ will be going up against Ratluck, the number one seed. James will be going up against the two seed and current world champion Greedy in the opening round this coming week. James R. Coffle taking the upper hand and hoping to keep it. Look for that table to potentially come into play. DZ missing the drop kick. James now with a finisher. And James picking up DZ. Kick to the midsection. He's going for the scoop slam. DZ out of reversals. And DZ with a big drop kick. What is it? Yeah, the beauty shot's allowed. Yeah, the beauty shot is allowed. Oh, wait a minute, James. Oh, James thrown back first into that exposed turnbuckle. DZ exposing that at the beginning of this match. And now James, Irish whipped on the table. DZ botches the first grapple. Running back. And James hanging on. Oh, no, I think DZ's waiting for James to get up. And James R. Coffle placed on that table. And now DZ, what is he thinking? Oh, James reverse. Oh, DZ nearly getting put through that table. Drop kick misses for DZ. James R. Coffle with a stunner. Finisher from James. Out of nowhere. James with the finisher. Hooks the leg center of the ring. One, two, and DZ with the shoulder up. Fast-paced back-and-forth match. These two go now. And a neck-breaker connecting for James R. Coffle. This is a good opportunity for both these two to scout each other out for their upcoming pay-per-view main event next month, obviously a couple weeks away, and on a different brand, so that does factor in ultimately, but still gives these guys an opportunity right now to take a look at some of the tendencies that the other will do in matches, and their match will be a multi-man come Superstars Reborn, but for now, certainly an opportunity to send a message to the other. James reintroducing the chair that his head was put into, and now denting that chair with the head of DZ. Bames just randomly trying to hit whatever he can now. Steel chair right over the steel steps. Bames Arakawa losing it. Now DZ up again. Chair shot. DZ avoids it. DZ dropping it. Oh, James nearly went through that table. And James, oh, up with a single leg breaker by DZ. DZ with the world's strongest slam to James. DZ locked and loaded with three finishers. So James Arakawa is gonna have to be careful, and James uses his comeback, and James is gonna go with it. A clothesline, another clothesline from James. DZ goes for one, ducked, and James with a super kick. He's got a signature in hand. DZ will roll to the outside and play it safe. James with a taunt and a little bit of commentary as DZ latching him with a kendo stick right across the side of those ribs. It certainly has lived up to the name of an Extreme Rules match. DZ, oh, what is he doing? Hurricane Rana, oh, James hit the steel steps. Stomp onto James from DZ. DZ, Irish whip, James reverses, putting DZ on the table. And now what's James doing? German suplex, DZ going through the table. DZ had been setting that up. He set it up in the beginning of this match. The intention was to put James through it the whole time, and it backfired. The Superstardom champion in all sorts of hurt right now. A German suplex. You guys, look at the table remains. That table is folded in half. Now, James is introducing another table. And DZ with that kendo stick, watch out, referee. DZ just going at anything he can swing at, and he found a weakness as James Arakawa re-enters the ring. And James is back down. This has been a painful match to watch, and it's been an even more painful one for both of these two to endure. DZ picking up James, who drop kicks the knee of DZ. DZ getting to both feet. Now James trying to show a little bit of the love that DZ showed him with that kendo stick being reintroduced, and now James yet again with the table. This time he'll set it up in a more formal setting, but something tells me they're not going to be having tea and donuts. James Arakawa, oh my gosh, what's this? Attitude adjustment! It bent the table. James Arakawa nearly having DZ. It might have broken a half a set of those table legs. DZ has been taking a beat down, and wait a minute, James yet again grabbing the table, and this time he's gonna set it up. Oh, he's leaning it on that rope. I'm not sure if that can break that way. Taking it again. And a table and out. Oh, table right to the ribs of DZ. James Arakawa just going away. Shot after shot with that table. Again, guys, this is just the opening match of tonight's Hardcore Sacrifice event. You're watching an Extreme Rules match, of course. This is the opener of the pay-per-view. We did have a kickoff match for you guys. If you just missed it, don't worry. It'll be available on YouTube sometime next week. Big Steph and Untamed fighting. Now you're watching James and DZ go at it. James missing. Targeting issue. That's going to benefit DZ. DZ with a big DDT. Two finishers and three in hand. DZ now seeing that table mess up. James using his second ring escape. He'll get on the apron, dropping back down. DZ using that table to play guard. And yet again, we are looking under the ring tonight. I'm not sure if there's going to be any weapons left for our main event. And I'm not sure. We're going to probably have to go get some tables in the back. Oh, wait a minute. DZ laying James on top of the table. That is quite a jump. DZ from the top rope, the exposed turnbuckle section, and he goes the other way. He goes towards me. That is how you be a heel, folks. That table, yeah, that table kind of, you guys see the table right now, sort of bent upwards on the set of steel steps, as you can see. Not sure how that, so I'm not sure if the table is equally balanced right now, or if perhaps it's a little bit of an uphill or a decline on one of those sides there. Table being used with the help of steel steps. These guys doing everything they can. James Arcoffel, oh, he's thrown into the steps in the corner there. DZ with another single leg breaker delivered to James. 20 plus viewers here live tuning into the sixth annual EIF Hardcore Sacrifice pay-per-view event. DZ now put in it. Oh, James trying for a drop kick, trying for some different offense here. And James throwing in those steel steps yet again. That table remains up. An awkward setting it might be. James circling the ring right now. And the ladder, DZ goes to the outside in the ladder, smacking him right across the face. James Arcoffel now turning DZ over. And, oh, DZ brought up only to be planted right back down that outside. James with the right hand missing wildly. DZ with a forearm, and James, oh, thrown into the ring post. We said these guys were throwing everything at each other, including the kitchen sink, and that has pretty much lived up to it. DZ, fireman's carried, caught part of his leg on that announce table, and now James thrown into the corner barricade. James reversing DZ. And now DZ thrown into that ladder while standing. The ladder remains up. James with a backbreaker from behind. Dropping to one knee, but James quick to get back. Three finishers in hand for each of these guys, either one with an opportunity to potentially end the match, but it's got to end in the ring. DZ using that recovery ability, really no reason in doing so. He's already got the maximum allowed in momentum. James with that quick drop kick. That could be taken a couple looks at, who knows if it will or not. James Arcoffel dragging DZ, who's, you guys can see, he's pretty much lifeless. The Superstorm champion is nothing but a body of bones right now. James Arcoffel gonna look to add to the pain for DZ. Oh, into the apron, into the steel ladder. DZ now on the announce table, and James Arcoffel picking DZ up on the announce table. Here we go. DZ brought up. DZ's gonna have to reverse. And a sit-back stunner through the announce table. A second table has been decimated, this one by ringside. Look at DZ, folks. DZ's body is practically twitching right now. James Arcoffel putting so much pain into and being inflicted on the Undisputed Superstorm champion, and he somehow got up. DZ has somehow got back to both feet. That table, drop kick, DZ drop kick, James Arcoffel, and he had to put himself through the table to reach over. That is the ultimate sacrifice, and DZ showing that he's willing to do anything to walk in and walk out of tonight with a victory. He may be doing so, and instead the tables were turned, or should I say chair, as DZ is driven head first into that steel chair, just as he had done so to James earlier. And James kendo sticking that top rope, just waiting for DZ to get up. DZ finisher zigzag. DZ with a finisher out of nowhere. 1-2, and James lives on. 1-1 finisher count here. We still have six more matches. This is absolutely crazy, and there's a table floating above the air. Does anybody see that? We have a table floating. Well, if I'm DZ and James, I want to get back in the ring because that table looks like it's about to drop on them out there. And that could be some serious damage. James Arcoffel needing the back. That table is quite distracting. I didn't realize that Extreme Rules meant they put the decor floating. I don't even see a string connecting it. That is talent, folks. Shout out to Hollywood Ratlug. That must have been one of his props that he has set up. Well, at least we know we have one more table in the arena for the tables match coming up. James Arcoffel, oh, big reversal into a powerbomb. It's just a 1-1 finisher count despite the extreme chaos that has been taking place so far in our first half hour of tonight's pay-per-view. James Arcoffel with a set of steel steps, DZ getting up, and he painfully is brought back down with the steps being driven into the face and upper body of DZ. James R. Koffel picking him up. Drop kick misses. DZ, finisher again! 2-1 finisher count. DZ looking to pin one of his challengers for the Superstar of Title match. Does he have it? 2, no! James R. Koffel getting the shoulder up. DZ turning James over. And now off the rope. Here comes DZ. Botch. You had to expect one, folks. It's been a long match. DZ with the kendo stick. James R. Koffel getting up. Here goes DZ and a shot right across the head. If blood was allowed in the game, these two would be shedding it. DZ bringing James back up again. A 2-1 finisher count. James now put into the turnbuckle. James will not want anything to do with that. And DZ now Irish whip off the rope. Here he comes. DZ reverse Irish whip off the rope. Comes James. DZ with a one-arm suplex. And yet again, still seeing new moves in this match. Quite the entertaining feat. It's split screened. Oh, wow. Huh. Well. DZ with a zigzag. When did it just split? When did it split screen for you? Oh, wow. All right, DZ with a 1-2. And it looks like that is going to end this matchup. A hell of a match, but an unfortunate ending. And the reason why I say that, folks, is not because DZ got the win, but because this match is actually a no contest. James R. Koffel had just split screened in his match about a minute or two before. James known to have a very honest reputation here in EIF, and so we do believe him. But these two certainly elevating what it takes to put on a hell of a pay-per-view quality match, and they did so. Can't wait to see what they do 2 weeks from now at Superstars Reborn. But again, DZ and James R. Koffel, despite what you see on the screen, ends in a no contest. Very unfortunate, but still a very good match between both these two competitors. And so now we move on to our next match, and it is a tables match, as we have our first of three championships on the line tonight, and this one looks like we'll be guaranteed a new champion. It is the Intercontinental Championship on the line, the scheduled champion Pepsi Killer, unable to defend, Deathlok, Midnight, and Tyron taking his place, and so we have a triple threat tables match. Here are the rules, guys. Very simple. The only thing is you need to hit a finisher before being eligible to eliminate your opponent, and I do want to make a public apology here to EBAMS. Bams, I know you've been waiting for a match. There's still a chance we could get you on if we end up having enough time or need a replacement later on, but unfortunately, Midnight Mayfire is here, so for you, that isn't going to work out. But anyway, Midnight is in the party too, correct? Is Midnight Mayfire in the party? Okay, he's probably just hopping on now and getting off Twitch. So anyway, guys, just to make sure everybody understands, you must hit a finisher before eliminating your opponent through a table. And also, of course, the only way to win is by putting your opponent through a table, and we do have a rule about that. Obviously, I am aware of some of the easier ways to put people through tables, one of which will not be allowed, and that is strong Irish whipping somebody through the table in the corner, as well as putting the person on the table in the corner and then running to put them through it. Now, you can still do what we saw happen in our last match. If you were to lay somebody on the table in the corner and then suplex them, German suplex them, do a Hurricane Rana to them, and it puts them through the table, that will count. I should probably exclude announce tables for this, I take it, right? Yeah. That just sounds right. Okay. So it must be a wooden table. That's fine. So those are the rules, guys. And again, the winner of this matchup is the person that is able to put an opponent through the table, and that person will become the Intercontinental Champion. Now, something, a disclaimer, I guess I should mention before we get into this match, just to let everybody know, for those of you that aren't very familiar with WWE 2K16 tables matches and how exactly they can sometimes go down, we do have some difficulties that occasionally happen as I am getting ready to make the match, at which point I'll ask our three competitors to join. So the match is up. Tyron, Midnight, and Deathlock, please go ahead and try your best to join this game. But as I had said, I have been reported by EIF officials that there have been some strange things that have happened in tables matches. Split screens have happened, just like we saw in our last match. We've also sometimes seen the screen pop up and say that somebody who wasn't even putting somebody through a table happened to win the match. Again, those are things that I'm not going to be allowing to actually take place. So in a hypothetical scenario, guys, if Deathlock were to suplex Tyron Hunt through the table, okay, that's fine. Just go ahead and just rejoin. It happens. But anyway, if Deathlock were to suplex Tyron Hunt through the table and the screen tells you that Tyron Hunt won, that will not be taken, despite the fact that Tyron would love for that to probably happen. That would result in Deathlock being credited with the win. And if for some reason something happens early on here and we think there is a problem, I will come up with an alternate solution, perhaps changing the stipulation if need be. This stipulation was originally set to be Deathlock versus Pepsi Killer in a one-on-one tables match. Obviously, that not happening due to Pepsi being unable to make it. And we want to make sure all of you guys are aware that coming up next, actually, after this matchup, the Battle for Glory All-Stars Tournament will be kicking off. So we're going to be getting away from the weapons a little bit and still keeping the same tone of seriousness as we'll head into the first matchup of the 2016 Battle for Glory All-Stars Tournament. We'll do a little bit more coverage on that tournament later on. And two of the three competitors in this match are actually involved in the BFG. And to be more specific, they're going to be going up against each other in the tournament. That's going to be Deathlock and Midnight Mayfire, the 5 and 12 seeds in this year's tournament, respectively. They'll challenge each other one-on-one later on next week for the preliminary round matchup. It will be Midnight Mayfire's tournament debut, and Deathlock will be looking to make a repeat to the finals as he had done last year, where he made it all the way as the number one seed. You guys notice, based on the character names in the top left, D-Lock Dudley, Deathlock, shouting out to Dudleyville, and of course that family is happened to be known just a little bit with tables, right? Just a little. So Deathlock will perhaps have a little bit of an advantage to his side. I don't see the glasses, Deathlock. No glasses. Contacts. Contacts. We're updating. We're updating. I should let everybody know that hitting a finisher before putting somebody through a table does not mean using a table finisher. You are allowed to use, like, you are allowed to use your finisher to put, like, if you have an attitude adjustment as your finisher, you can use it to put them through the table. Just make sure that you do a regular attitude adjustment before. And we will do in-ring introductions for this matchup before getting started here. I will do my best to get out of the way. Again, targeting will be an issue. The next several matches, it hopefully will not. The following contest is a triple threat tables match and is for the vacant EIF Intercontinental Championship. Introducing first, starting in the bottom right and then around, from Houston, Texas, Tyron Hunt. Next, from Detroit, Michigan, Midnight Mayfire. One taunt for Midnight. One long taunt for Midnight. And introducing last, from West Virginia, now residing in Dudleyville, he is Deathlock! Alright guys, ready? Ding, ding, ding! And our tables match for the Intercontinental Championship is underway. Tyron Hunt starting it out by interrupting, and Tyron actually won a pinfall triple threat against Big Steph and Ebams to get into and qualify for this Intercontinental Championship match. Midnight Mayfire, Tyron Hunt, and Deathlock, all former Intercontinental Champions, so they have history with this title. And all three of them will need to hit a finisher in order to get one step closer to winning this championship, as Midnight Mayfire with a hook line neck breaker to Deathlock. Tyron Hunt trying to get involved, and he's hooked too. Deathlock with a zigzag from behind. The finisher we saw DZ use a couple times on James in our last matchup. Tyron Hunt now choking the life out of Midnight. Targeting will certainly be an issue, not just for the sake of me, but for the fact this is a triple threat match. We've already seen it taking place, and D-Lock Dudley is struggling. Now he's able to get something. Tyron Hunt, Irish whipped, brought back, Spinebuster stopped. And this is a smart move by these guys, trying to avoid giving any momentum to their counterpart, knowing that they have to hit a finisher in order to be eligible. Midnight Mayfire strongly thrown into that turnbuckle in the bottom left corner. Luckily, it's not the same exposed turnbuckle that we saw in the last matchup. James Arcoffel was thrown right into the steel buckle. And Midnight Mayfire going off the rope, kick to the back, and uppercut catches him from Deathlock. Currently leading the way right now is Midnight Mayfire in momentum. Deathlock trailing in last, and now he'll jump over Tyron with a knockout punch. Midnight Mayfire with a forearm to the face. Three reversals for Midnight, four for Deathlock, just used one of them, and Tyron Hunt looks like he'll be about to get his fifth back, assuming that he doesn't use it too early. And Deathlock uses a reversal, mid-move reversal, that costs you two. And Deathlock to the outside. And going out with him is Midnight Mayfire. Plunging out, Tyron Hunt goes. All three men caught up, but Midnight Mayfire able to stay up. I'm going to avoid doing what I had done in the last match, not just for targeting issues, but running around the ring to help the camera angle. Reason being is that there are two tables set up on the side there, and I don't want to interfere with them. So Tyron Hunt throwing the law down on Deathlock. Kick to the back. All three of these men even pretty much in momentum. Tyron Hunt picking up Deathlock. Neckbreaker connects, and Tyron the first to get a signature. So he is getting close. And you want to be very careful that you don't accidentally put someone through a table if you're Tyron Hunt, because you do that, you end up disqualifying yourself. That's obviously not the way you want to lose a match. Certainly not the way you never want to hear about a disqualification at a pay-per-view named Hardcore Sacrifice. It happens. Deathlock missing and taken out with a neckbreaker from Midnight Mayfire. These tables can be very fragile at times. We have seen it in the past. Midnight Mayfire in the ring. And this is not good if you're Midnight. You're allowing Deathlock and Tyron to get some momentum off each other. STO stopped. Oh, Midnight Mayfire, I guess, kind of got stoned to the outside. Tyron Hunt and Deathlock in the ring. Tyron Hunt looking for, oh, I don't know what he was, oh, the Brainbuster. And that was a signature. Tyron Hunt has a finisher. Deathlock does too, but Deathlock is out of reversals. He gets caught with a knee right to the groin, it looks like. Tyron Hunt. Oh, wait a minute. Tyron Hunt sees that Deathlock is out of reversals, but Deathlock just got one back. Is Tyron Hunt going to go for it anyway? He does not. He does now. Looking for the Styles Clash, and Deathlock reversed him. Oh, that was a big reversal there. Deathlock and Midnight playing a bit of bumper cars. And a signature from Deathlock. He has no reversals, but he does have two finishers. He only needs to hit one to be eligible. And he'll slide to the outside. Now, I don't know why he's trying to run up the ramp. Deathlock, be a little careful, because when we run up the ramp, I notice a lot of split screens happen. It's happened before, so. And Mayfire having targeting issues. Tyron Hunt will gladly take advantage. And Deathlock, what is he doing? Oh, a steel chair. He's sitting that chair down, not sure. Oh, he might have been going for that table. Deathlock is not eligible yet, though. He's got to be careful. He's going to put that table down. Tyron Hunt will gain a signature now. Deathlock taking one table down. And I see what Deathlock's doing. This is a smart move. Deathlock placing these tables down, guys, because when you're thrown on the apron, if somebody chooses to spear you off the apron, you can actually go through the table. That was a smart move by Deathlock. It was also a respectful move. Deathlock showing, hey, I'm not trying to win that way either. And that's definitely a class move that you like to see here in the mid-card by a guy like him who's been to the main event level. Oh, and for some reason, Tyron went for the signature at 149.5. There is a reason that guy never made it to the main event. I don't know what Tyron Hunt was thinking. He literally was a taunt away, a strike away, and now Deathlock is the one that hit the finisher. Tyron is the one without, and so now Deathlock can look to regain the Intercontinental Championship. Now we had said that announce tables were banned in this match in terms of being used. So Deathlok will not be able to use that announce table to put an opponent through. Meanwhile, Midnight Mayfire looking to gain some precious momentum. He, too, has a finisher. He has not used one, though. And wait a minute. And he has right there. Midnight Mayfire is also eligible. And Midnight is going to go right to the outside and look to grab a table and pick up the table along with perhaps his third Intercontinental Championship reign. Kip up. And Deathlok will send him out. And over the top he goes with them all three men down. What a triple threat. Our first of two multi-mans this evening. The next one will be in our main event. Tyron Hunt over the top rope. And Deathlok is frozen. And I really hope it's not a permanent one because that's, he's luckily not. Oh, thank goodness. All right, guys, let's pick Deathlok up. All right, Tyron, I didn't think you think freezing the guy meant you could hit him for free. Jesus. All right, Deathlok, you're good. All right, re-go, guys, let's go. Remember, that table, you don't need to be put through the table on the inside of the ring to win. I think Deathlok remembers that. I don't know if Midnight does. Midnight Mayfire laid on top of the table. Tyron Hunt. Tyron Hunt. Oh, signature from Deathlok. Midnight Mayfire's got to get up. Midnight Mayfire. And Midnight Mayfire slapped on the chest. Deathlok. Tyron Hunt's got to get up. Tyron Hunt's got to stop him. And Midnight Mayfire gets off the table. Deathlok goes through and nobody home. Midnight Mayfire avoids that table shot. Deathlok going through the table, but again, nobody home there. The match continues. 30 plus viewers now. Tyron's still ineligible to win this match. Frog splash to the outside. And Tyron wants to make sure he avoids that table. Getting pancaked by it will help. Again, triple threat tables match for the Intercontinental Championship. Deathlok yet again with Midnight Mayfire on the table. And Deathlok, what is he thinking? Deathlok, oh, wait a minute. Deathlok to the top rope. Tyron's got to stop him. Tyron. Can Tyron stop him? He can't do it. Deathlok is the new Intercontinental Champion. Tyron was never eligible. He was playing dumb in the match, and he played dumb at the end. And Deathlok wins the Intercontinental Championship. Very good matchup. Deathlok had to go through two tables, but this time one of them had Midnight on it. And so one title, as we had mentioned, was guaranteed to change. That one, the Intercontinental Championship, has. We still have two championship matches to go tonight, and we also have some Battle for Glory All-Stars tournament action coming your way. Boy, is it going to be exciting. Well, it has been an extreme start to Hardcore Sacrifice this year. But Extreme will be toned down just a bit in our upcoming matches. And so coming up next, it is time for the Battle for Glory All-Stars Tournament to officially kick off after so much hype, after so much discussion, so much talking about it. 3 weeks ago, we revealed the seeds for the tournament. 3 weeks later, we will now begin the tournament. And we're going to begin this tournament with the number 8 seed versus the number 9 seed. It's a rematch for these two competitors from where they last left off, Aaron versus Frost. Now, before we get to that, let's re-bring you in. And for those that aren't as aware about the Battle for Glory All-Stars Tournament, let's talk a little bit more about what exactly this tournament is and how it works. The Battle for Glory All-Stars tournament was a tournament that started in EIF back in 2012. Originally a 12-person tournament, this was brought in initially to be a side act that would determine the best in EIF outside of EIF shows, pay-per-views, etc. That year, Brutality would go on to be the first ever Battle for Glory All-Stars tournament winner, winning it at the number 7 seed, and after yet again winning the tournament in the second and third edition of the BFG as the first seed, Brutality had respectfully stepped down, giving a new opportunity last year in a tournament that sponsored a new style bracket, being the challenge type, which brought in set brackets as opposed to the reseeding format that we had done round by round in the previous three tournaments. Now in 2016, this now 16 seed tournament still is meant to determine the best in EIF. However, it is gathered so much mainstream that we keep it around in regular shows as well as pay-per-views, as the Battle for Glory All-Stars tournament went from an idea, a project, and a risk to being one of the most looked forward to events in Extreme International Fighting each and every year. This year is no different, and the fifth installment is promising to bring much excitement. We're going to start it out with two superstars that fought each other in last year's edition of the tournament. By the way, Greedy, please watch this with me. Greedy, are you there? All right, yep. Actually, he'll probably hear you. He'll probably hear me and then get back. Yeah, he'll just... All right. Go ahead, guys, and please join the match. The match is up. This is for Greedy to watch, along with Aaron and Frost. Tripod, I'm not 100%. I would strongly suggest not trying to take a risk in this tournament. But either way, again, guys, this... the winner of this tournament, I should mention, the finals of the Battle for Glory All-Stars tournament will take place at EIF Collision Course on Saturday, June 11th. And just to remind everybody again, 16 superstars are starting out the tournament. This opening round is our preliminary round. The round is single elimination. It is in normal rules. That means that the match can result in an end via the following: a disqualification, a ring countout of 10, or a pinfall victory, as well as a mercy rule via the 7 finisher count. I sent you a game invite, Frost. The winner of this matchup will move on to round 2, and round 2 is the quarterfinal round. The round of 8 is a best of 3, so the first person with 2 victories to win there will advance on to the semifinals, which is a best of 5, and from there the final 4 will turn into just 2, and our remaining 2 superstars will compete Saturday, June 11th at the EIF Collision Course pay-per-view event in a best of 7. The first person to win 4 matches in that best of 7 that night, which will all feature multiple different stipulations, will be the Battle for Glory tournament winner and will get to pick a prize of their choosing. So, guys, we apologize for the slight delay here. Technical difficulty for Frost, so he is yet again getting back on the game. And I guess to be safe, Frost, I'll go ahead and remake the match, just so that way we don't have any issues. So, again, remaking the match. And also, I want to remind everybody that after this matchup, we will be taking a brief timeout. And then when we come back, we will be having our entrances and our matches with entrances. Still 4 matches to go following this. 3 more BFGs. This is going to be a BFG power hour or more coming up now, because our next 4 matches are the Battle for Glory tournament. So once again, guys, the match is up. Please go ahead and join. That's because I quit the game. There you go. we're just going to go ahead here and wait. Obviously, if worse comes to worse, we can always try and make this game without greedy. It looks like we won't have to worry about that. So don't forget, guys, I will be doing in-ring entrances, so please do not begin attacking each other. And these matches are heavily watched. Aaron and Frost, as we had mentioned, fought each other last year. Aaron won that match only to go on and be eliminated in the quarterfinal round. But Aaron and Frost, last year was Frost's tournament debut. Aaron has been in multiple tournaments. In fact, Aaron has never lost in the opening round of the Battle for Glory All-Stars tournament. So as a fun fact, there's a couple of guys actually coming into this tournament that have never lost in round one. One of them is Hostile Exile. He'll be competing also later on this evening against Wicked Jr. in the BFG. Wicked making his second stint in the Battle for Glory. Hostile participating in his fifth BFG tournament. He has never missed one, and he has never lost in the opening round. Hostile has made it to the semifinals as well multiple times. I believe Hostile is a two-time semifinalist and a two-time quarterfinalist. My history would have to be probably checked. I know he has never lost in the opening round. That I can guarantee. So sometimes the loading time does take a little bit longer based on the fact that created wrestlers are used. Also, Frost may have just a bit of paint tool. I could be wrong about that, but something tells me I'm not. Same thing. I don't even see the... Yeah, we're probably gonna have to crash. I don't want our viewers to tune out yet. Just wait and we'll see what happens. But I haven't even seen the loading bar pop up, so... Yeah, then it's probably gonna disconnect us. Yep, network error has occurred. Alright. I'll go ahead and... Well, we can remake it. I mean, do we need to crash, or... Yeah, you two might need to crash. I'm not sure. So, I do apologize to our viewers. I know the wait kind of sucks, and obviously, of all matches, you really want to... These Battle for Glory matches to get underway. There's obviously a lot of excitement surrounding the BFG. There always is yearly. So, certainly hoping that that this will change, and we'll get some additional stuff here going. And in the meantime, guys, for those that are still listening in, make sure you follow us here on the EIF Network. You may get a shout-out. Shout-out to Maverick for Real and VincentKid909. Thank you for following us here on the EIF Network. And you, too, may get your name heard over the stream. Just make sure you follow us here on Twitch. And in the meantime, you can check us out as well on some of our affiliate sites, Twitter, YouTube, and, of course, our website over on League Lineup. We're going to go ahead and remake this match. They say third time's the charm. This is the third time. Let's hope. One of the big things that is a storyline heading into this particular Battle for Glory matchup is the ring rust. Frost has not been seen mainstream on EIF since WrestleMania, which was nearly 2 months ago, so... Frost's inexperience in the ring could come back to haunt him, although he's had a history of being very good at picking up things quick. That's how Frost was able to return to EIF last year after a multi-year hiatus and then going on in just a few months to win the Undisputed Superstardom Championship. Frost has a history of adapting. It's what got him into the EIF Hall of Fame, and it's what made him a main event superstar. Guys, if you do hear the network error, please try to rejoin. It did happen to Deathlock during the Intercontinental title match. He rejoined and the match was fine. So that does happen. Obvious. All right. So, guys, there are some technical difficulties going on for Frost yet again here. So, Frost has not played the game in a while, and that might be one of the reasons why maybe his console isn't too fond of the game being started up. So, we might see something here. We have myself, Greedy, and Aaron yet again in the match. So, perhaps my third time's the charm was a commentator's curse. That does happen a lot to me. All right, so Frost is going to go ahead and restart his game. We're just going to go ahead and sit here. So my apologies once again to the viewers. And as I had said earlier in the broadcast, if you guys have been I know a lot of you guys are EIF superstars. So if you've seen the network, if you've seen EIF on Twitch, you know this is the story. It's a sad story, realistically. It's not something that we're happy about. It's not something we're proud of, certainly. And for whatever reason it is, the Twitch servers or WWE servers or a combination of both always happen to act up on us when we happen to be wanting to do a pay-per-view. So it is what it is, and we're just gonna have to keep on chugging along with it, guys. So now is definitely that time to go use the bathroom, get some popcorn, do what you need to do, and then following that, we will go ahead and yet again do a match. I should mention once more, after this matchup, we are going to be taking a break. Not a break for an extended period of time, but just going to a quick commercial break. And we'll actually be switching stream providers on Twitch after this matchup, as Ratluck will be taking care of some duties for entrance purposes. Thanks to him and the help of Elgato Game Capture, we'll see entrances for the other three BFG matches and the World Championship main event. We should also mention that one of those three BFG matches that will be streamed with entrances will also be for the X Division Championship. Lizman and Beatdown are set to go. Actually, I believe that one's next. If I am looking at the order of the card correct, Lizman and Beatdown could be coming up next. So, and one of the other things that we had talked about with those entrances that we wanted to make sure we get feedback with you guys. And by the way, everybody, please make sure that we try to get Frost back in this party. I saw that he got back online, so you guys could help me out in getting him here. But one of the other things that we had mentioned with the entrances there, which is something I would really love to hear back from you guys, and that's some feedback as to what we're going to be seeing here. And what you guys like here on Twitch, because our top goal is to satisfy you, the viewers, whether that is some of our superstars. Obviously, we know there's a big fan base that's within EIF, but of course, we can appreciate people beyond it. I had actually saw Vincent909, one of our newest followers, talking a little bit with Hostile Exile on the chat earlier this evening during our pre-show, and he's not a member of the EIF roster, but clearly a fan of Twitch and a fan of the EIF network. And so we are trying to make sure that whatever we provide to you is the utmost of satisfactory towards you guys. So make sure you let us know towards the end of the broadcast. Maybe I'll try to re-put that point out there and just tell us, did you like it more when we had entrances for every match? Do you like this pace, which is a little bit faster? Obviously, we can't help the technical difficulties, entrances or not. That's going to happen. Do you like having any entrances at all? Or whatever it may be, we're here to satisfy you guys. So let's go ahead and try to satisfy you a little bit more by having an actual match as opposed to nothing but dialogue as we get set to make this match here. Frost is going to yet again try, and we're going to hope as the match is up. It is an open game session, as Aaron likes to always remind me kindly. And go ahead and join Aaron, Frost, and Greedy. Yeah, what a great character he was. Aaron, I'm sorry, not Aaron. Frost, never mind, you don't need an invite. Also, you know what? I know this isn't all ED pay-per-view, but I should mention in the meantime, don't forget to tune in next time, 2 weeks from now. That's right, I know a lot of people in EIF love, especially the fans, love just a two-week gap. And a network error for Frost. It looks like his connection is absolutely phenomenal, but he's going to go ahead and rejoin. Seriously, you should be able to rejoin. It shouldn't be a problem. But as I was saying, though, guys, just 2 weeks from now, I know people love the short wait in between pay-per-views. Saturday, May 14th, catch us at 8 p.m. Eastern, but 7 p.m. for the pre-show. It's EIF's 6th annual Superstars Reborn. This pay-per-view tonight featuring all ED. That pay-per-view will feature all Superstardom. And even more, even better, it's going to be featuring the Superstardom Draft. People have been waiting for it. I know there's been some complaints. Some guys have not liked the wait. Some people telling me this was a little bit of a longer wait, and it was, in fairness to them. Last year's was, I believe, 3 weeks earlier than this year's. I do apologize to the fans and the superstars mainly that complained about that one. I just want to let you guys know, just sometimes scheduling conflicts do occur. That was one of those instances. Again, we're doing our best to make sure that we'll have that draft for you guys. And we have 12 superstars already guaranteed to get to actually pick the character they want. And if you're an EIF superstar and you want the opportunity to pick the character you will get for the remaining portion of WWE 2K16, if you do not want to be randomized and risk getting somebody like Heath Slater, Darren Young, Santino Marella, Natalya. Actually, you're not going to be able to get Natalya because we don't have Divas roster. But as I was saying there, guys, if you want to avoid that, make sure you contact me for additional information. You can send me a message here on Xbox, best way to contact me, and I'll make sure I try to get back to you as soon as possible. I will say that, you know, for those that know me outside of EIF, this is finals week coming up here at college, so I may not be as available as I usually am on Xbox, but I'll do my best to make sure that I get in touch with you. And a superstar can make a difference. I mean, let's talk about James Arcoffel competing earlier this evening. He's more of a superstar guy, as many people know. And he became Randy Orton at the start of this year, and what a transformation. This guy was pretty much, and he knows, I mean, no disrespect, James, very close friend of mine. Great superstar, even better friend. But a guy who obviously last year struggled, was pretty much a jobber. Go ahead, Greedy. And look at this year. Look at the transformation. He's went from jobber to now going to main event in 2 weeks. So, anyway, guys, we finally have competitors in the ring. Here we go. The following contest is the first match of the 2016 Battle for Glory All-Stars Tournament. Introducing first in the top left corner, from Columbus, Ohio, he is representing the number 9 overall seed, Aaron Phantom. Aaron, you have to get in the ring. He's going to mess up the count. And now, his opponent standing across the ring from him, from New Hampshire, representing the number 8 seed, this is Frost. All right, guys, remember, single elimination. Frost, are you ready? Aaron, are you ready? All right, here we go, guys. Let the BFG begin. Ding, ding, ding. And it is Aaron and Frost. The Battle for Glory All-Stars Tournament is underway with a back suplex from the higher seed, Frost. And obviously, of all the high seed versus low seed matchups, 8 and 9 can sometimes be one of the most intriguing because it's kind of hard to say that one of them is an underseed going against each other. Aaron has actually been involved in this seed battle. Aaron, if I'm correct, I think, weren't you guys like the same seeds last year? Oh, you were seed 4. Oh, my, wow, I forgot. You really were high up. And then the year before, though, Aaron, I believe you were seed 9. So this is Aaron's, oh, seed 11. Oh, botch. All right. Well, you know what? I felt like at one point he was seed 9. Whatever. He's seed 9 here in 2016. But obviously, past does not matter right now. It is all about the present, and Frost is all about now. Talk about ring rust. We talked about, you know, Frost not competing in about two months. And sometimes, believe it or not, that can actually be an advantage to Frost, who spits out some, I'm just going to say that was ketchup, but anyway, though, you know, that can be an advantage for a guy like Frost, because a superstar like Aaron, it doesn't matter, despite the experience that Aaron's had in EIF of 4 years, sometimes you can just sense that there's an issue. Oh. Yeah, why are you doing that, Greedy? You just yelled at Tripod for doing that shit earlier, and then you go and say that. So, anyway. Frost does have a bad move. What move? So Frost has been spotted of a banned move, and obviously in the Battle for Glory more than any other time, they are heavily watched. Right now, I think Frost might have made his guy a super heavyweight. I could be mistaken, and he is completely allowed to do so. And so that's certainly helping him in the health category. Aaron is still trying to get Frost out of green. And speaking of that, while Hybrid is in the party, one of Hybrid's predictions was that Aaron would beat Frost and actually green bar Frost. It's quite a bold prediction. And that is proven false, although the outcome in terms of the winner is yet to be determined. 20-plus viewers again live here for Hardcore Sacrifice. We thank you so much for tuning in and being patient with us through our first big stretch of technical difficulties throughout the night. We hope it's the only stretch. As Aaron with a kick to the midsection, waiting for Frost to sit up, and then he stomps him back down. Signature in hand for Aaron, who is not leading in health, but in momentum. He is stopped by Frost, and a quick snapping suplex connects. Last time we saw Frost, he was trying to climb his way up to winning the Money in the Bank, and boy, did he come close that night. But since then, a bit of anger swelled up inside the EIF Hall of Famer. I'm not going to call it. It was from side. No, it's fine. It's fine. I know. That can be a warning. Aaron to the outside. Ring escape. He's not talking about you, Frost. He's talking about Greedy. Because Greedy goes, I'm sorry to get out of commentary character, but I have to insult Greedy when given the opportunity. Inziguri connects from Aaron. Frost is out of green. This match continues. Both superstars with signatures. Did Aaron reverse it? All right. Okay, yeah, just keep it going. Aaron shouldn't really get three free moves. He's already in the offense. Kick to the lower back. Greedy doesn't know about EIF. Come on. Well, that's one of the disadvantages that Frost actually does have. Aaron going for the scoop slam. It's reversed. I'll tell you one thing that I do give Frost a hell of a lot of credit for, and that's his conservation. Is that the Samoan Blitz? Okay. Huge combo from Frost. That was the signature. Both these guys have been extremely conservative in reversals. Aaron needs to be now because he could be getting hit with a finisher any moment now. Irish whip into the corner goes Aaron. Frost plunging into him with a clothesline. You can tell the size advantage certainly on the half of the 8-seed Frost. And a pop-up powerbomb into a pinfall. That could be it. One. Two, and Frost nearly putting away Aaron. You know, those brackets closed up at 8. I think DZ said we can actually see everybody's predictions now. I'd love to see how many people have Frost predicted to go over Aaron and vice versa. Certainly is a stat that I think I'll try to make sure we pull up here for the next matchups. Aaron with a jawbreaker. It's fine, it happens. Scissor kick to the face of Frost from Aaron. At least your finisher's not banned. Yeah, that would have been game over, so at least you're good there. I don't know what your other finisher is, but something tells me you should stick to this one. Anyway, snap mirror from... I don't know if that's banned. Anyway, finisher in hand. Running super kick. Aaron now picking up Frost. Inziguri misses. Frost with a signature. Oh! And I think he might have been going for that combo again. Aaron with another snap mirror and a kick to that lower back. Aaron's got to play the ground game here. I really think that's going to help him out. Is that it? Have you checked every one of them? Wow. All right, so just a news update for everybody, thanks to our great services from Hybrid Maniac. Just to fill everyone in, signature, by the way, hit for Frost. Out of the, I believe, 12 or 13 brackets submitted from EIF, Only one bracket predicted Frost to beat Aaron. That was NBC Master, who's been in a match with Frost. He was involved in Money in the Bank with him. And a finisher reversal for Aaron. Aaron with two finishers. So again, only one predicting that Frost would move on. Everybody else predicting Aaron to advance and underseed at number nine. Aaron looking to advance to his third straight quarterfinal appearance, but he is down 1-0 in the finisher count. I believe that is his first taunt. So 1-0 taunts. I don't think Frost had a taunt. And Aaron, oh, you did? My bad. Oh, yeah, you did. I'm sorry. I don't know why. Yeah, the catch-up taunt. Okay, 1-1. I was so creeped out by it, I wanted to forget it. So Aaron rolling Frost over now, picking him up. Aaron, kick to the midsection. Frost says no. Flips him into a headlock. Knee to the... I don't know if that caught Aaron up high. That one certainly did. And Aaron will be seeing stars. Back and forth they go. Again, this is the first of eight preliminary round matchups in this year's Battle for Glory All-Stars tournament. And you gotta love the offense. Aaron with that fast pace, not as high flying as he's usually, but Frost, of course, trying a more ground and pound, a punishing style being taken from Frost. And the one you just did. I think, isn't the other one he did banned too? Right back kick? Oh, okay. All right, Aaron. Oh, Inzaguri, and now Aaron with three finishers. So he's down 1-0 in the finisher count, but he certainly has an upper hand. And kick to the midsection. I don't know if I didn't see that move before. That was a neck breaker, and it was not a finisher. Oh, I got excited for nothing. Thanks. You tease. And now Aaron reversed from Frost. And here comes that signature again. Frost unloading on Aaron. Kick to the chest, another kick to the chest, and oh, third one will drop Aaron down to the ground, and another finisher in hand for Frost. He caught Aaron sleeping on him last time, and that's a second taunt for Frost. 2-1 taunts more used by Frost. The 8 seed challenging Aaron, the 9 seed, a 2015 Battle for Glory opening round rematch. Oh, that all I thought was going to be the super kick. Instead, it's the pop-up powerbomb. It's a 2-0 finisher count. Frost could be moving on. 1-2. And Aaron staying alive. Well, you know, I mentioned before we started this match, guys, Frost is the kind of guy, when you're a Hall of Famer in this league, when you've won a main event championship multiple times like he has, you cannot take this guy off for a minute. It doesn't matter if he didn't play the game for a year. Frost has skill, and he has a lot of it. He's showing that to Aaron right now. And it has been back and forth, but oh, nice German. I think I'm going to say Frost, though, has still been more dominant. I am very impressed with Frost's performance tonight. Aaron obviously still showing some skill as well, and Aaron's still very much in this match. It's only a 2-0 finisher count, but he doesn't want it to get away from him to where he has to scratch and claw to stay in it. He's got the offense now. Aaron's just got to maintain. Three reversals standing each aside. Right hand from Aaron. A left, and I believe going for the suplex. He does, standing vertical suplex, and a signature in hand for Aaron. Aaron now dragging Frost, kick to the midsection. And again, we talk about keeping Frost grounded, and that's what Aaron's trying to do. I think both these guys showing a little bit of similar styles. Aaron going to put his second taunt in. Is that going to get him a finisher? Yes, it is. Three total in hand for Aaron, four reversals in hand for Frost. Aaron about to gain his fourth reversal. And the kick, it was a reverse. And that was good on Aaron's end. And he's able to maintain offense. That's a positive side for the number 9 seed, who picks up Frost, his 8 seed counterpart, right hand. And Frost with a right kick. Aaron with a reversal. Frost with a reversal. Signature in hand for Frost. Aaron, DDT reversal. Back and forth they go. And now Aaron, measured up knee to the face of his opposition. Just two reversals in hand, and Aaron with his third taunt beginning to feel signs of life. Aaron again, still down though, 2-0 in the finisher count. Trying to cut the gap in half. A running forearm, and that's a finisher. Aaron with the forearm strike, finisher, and that could be at center of the ring. One, two, and Frost powers out this time. So the finisher count cut in half. The momentum, stress, pressure, excitement, anxiety, and every other word that can describe what a Battle for Glory All-Stars tournament feels like. It's beginning to sink in on these competitors, and it's beginning to damper in on the fans, and they are eating it up, as are Greedy and I, who have a front row seat. Aaron with a kick to the midsection of Frost. Aaron, I think, kind of surprised Frost with that finisher there. And the only problem is now Frost knows what that finisher is, so Aaron's going to have to make sure that he's able to catch him again. And he does, and it's a different finisher. It's a different finisher. Go to sleep, connects. 2-2. 1-2. And Frost gets out of it. Forget the finisher count. It's a best of five now in terms of the finishers, but this match continues. Neckbreaker connects. Due to poor network performance, the voice chat feature has been disabled. We're almost at the midway point of our show. Still four matches to go here. Aaron, right hand reversed. And now Frost beginning to show a little bit more signs of desperation as he hits that running cross elbow. I definitely can feel more desperation in Frost now. Legs in between the head and smashing Aaron face first on that canvas. Frost now with the upper hand once more. And he's disrespecting our referee. Third taunt for Frost. 3-3 in taunts. Frost is literally a tenth of a percentage away from getting a finisher. That uppercut stopped from Aaron. Aaron with a plate of chops. Left hand, and Aaron with a finisher. Aaron, from being down 2-0, is up 3-2. Into the pin combo. Wait a minute, his hand isn't on the rope. Two. And Aaron, somehow though, did not move on. Rope break is on in this match, and for some reason our ref did not get a good view there. Right hand, Aaron still keeping offense. Wow, what a rally this has been for Aaron. Frost has looked like a desperate man, and Aaron is making him feel that way, and it's another finisher. Go to sleep, pin combo, is it over? One, two, and it is over. Aaron rallies from behind, and the ninth seed advances. What a match. Perhaps the match of the night. It has all been good matches. And Aaron advances. So for the third year in a row, Aaron moving on to the quarterfinals, but not without a fight from Frost, who certainly threatened Aaron multiple times in the match. But Aaron with a hellacious rally. Something snapped in Aaron somewhere in that match towards the end where he realized he needed to wake up, and he did. Four unanswered finishers that led to the win, and our number nine seed, Aaron Phantom, the first superstar to move on in this year's Battle for Glory All-Stars tournament. It's been an action-packed first half of Hardcore Sacrifice, and we still have more to come, including three consecutive Battle for Glory All-Stars championship or tournament matchups, one of them being for a championship, and that's the one that's coming up next. We're going to take a quick break. Don't go away. When we come back, the X Division championship and BFG matchup between the number six seed, Beatdown, who is the defending champion, against the former champion, the 11 seed, Lizman. We'll be back here on Hardcore Sacrifice.